This is it. The last entry in this trilogy. Might and Magic 8. Day of the Destroyer. I sure have some things to tell about this one. So, as far as I know, Might and Magic 8 was a bit of a flop. It was released in the year 2000 and it still used the old sprite-based engine. So even at the time it looked a bit dated compared to games released the same year like Thief 2, or even earlier like Half-Life. And a lot of innovations the game did get, a large part of the old fanbase did not appreciate. I was clueless about all that when I first played the game though. It was my first Might and Magic game. I remember my dad getting it together with a new PC and it looked so good. The character portraits were so real. So, as the first game in the series I played, it has a lot of sentimental value for me, but there are more things I like it for. The atmosphere is one of the main attractions for me. The game made a fairly big shift in tone, changing from high fantasy into dark fantasy. Might and Magic 8 is full of vampires, necromancers, all that good stuff. The colors are more muted, yet as beautiful as ever. Just look at the sky. And the armor and weapon designs are really cool. I also really appreciate the improved UI. It got rid of that huge nasty bar design of the screen, making the UI more compact and giving more space for the actual environment. This is a little irrelevant nowadays, as Gray Faces patch changes the UI into something even sleeker. It also enables widescreen support and upscales textures, so the game looks better than ever before. But let's get down to the more technical stuff. Gameplay-wise, this game is an odd one out in the trilogy. That's obvious right from the character creation screen. Notice how I said character, not party. The character creation is way different. You don't get to choose any class for any portrait anymore. Classes are tied to each character. Also, races are also classes now. I know it sounds confusing, but you'll see. One of the two classes that return from the previous games is Knight. The melee weapon master that cannot use any magic but can learn a bunch of utility skills. Then there's Cleric, a healer and a light magic user that's crucial to any party. Now, instead of a sorcerer, we get a necromancer. It's essentially the same thing, but they also specialize in dark magic right from the beginning. And then there's the first race class, a vampire. Vampires are pretty much jacks of all trades and they can get pretty OP. They can use a wide assortment of weapons and armor, learn a lot of utility skills, and healing and dark schools of magic, along with a unique vampire ability, which is also a school of magic in itself. Dark elves are very similar to vampires in the sense that they also can learn a lot of different skills and only grandmaster few of them, but they focus more on archery and utility skills. When it comes to magic, they can learn elemental spells and the unique dark elf ability, which allows them to get better prices at stores and charm people using their soft, shiny, dark skin. Minotaurs. I freaking love Minotaurs. In some cases they kinda suck, but there's something that makes me really like them. They just look kinda cute. Anyway, they're sorta like paladins in this game. They can use healing schools of magic and grandmaster plate armor and axe skills. Their unique bodies do not allow them to wear helmets or boots, but they're still very tanky as they get a lot of HP. They also don't seem to be able to wear shields, which is a bit odd. And lastly, there are trolls. They are the equivalent of barbarians in this game. Just like knights, they cannot use any magic, but they're very strong using blunt weapons and can dual wield maces. They can also only wear leather armor, which would make them seemingly more vulnerable, but they're still very tough as they can grandmaster leather armor, regeneration and bodybuilding. Having played through this game, I could say that some classes are more viable for the main character than others, simply because of the recruitment system. I believe that turned a lot of old fans away actually, because in all previous games you could create the whole party. You can still do that here with certain mods, but I actually enjoy the recruitment system. I think it makes all the characters feel more like actual characters, because they have their own backstories. I get actually attached to them, Devlin especially. That cynical necromancer is so much fun. He's irreplaceable in any party of mine, just because of his catchphrase.
It's worthless.
He says it nearly every single time when identifying an item. His tone is so perfectly condescending. And he's only 21 years old when you recruit him. Damn, necromancy is taking its toll on him. Frederick is another important cast member as he's the first healer you can recruit, but he's a bit of an asshole. When you first go to the Snake Temple, you find Simon Templar there. Look at his crazed eyes. He's seen some crap down there. I kinda like him, but I'd find it scary to fall asleep next to this guy. And a bit later in the game, you get to recruit a beautiful dark elf, Corey Blackthorn, who's a big boost to party power as she's the strongest person you can recruit fairly early on. Those are some of the more important and memorable characters to me. But knowing the people I will be able to recruit at any point in the game makes me want to make a character that would complement them, and I don't want duplicate classes in my party. So my main picks are Cleric, because any party needs one, or a Vampire or a Dark Elf, mostly because of the utility skills. There's also 5 character slots instead of 4 now, allowing for more flexibility, which is really nice. Story-wise, there was a mysterious dude who just made a giant pink crystal in the middle of a city and just blessed a bunch of people all over the world, so there's a massive crisis everywhere now. The main character is just some dude who got stuck in Daggerwound Island with a trader caravan. Yoink, my goods now. Oh wait, maybe I should talk to my buddy here and not just steal first thing after starting the game. Nah. But yeah. Daggerwound Islands are constantly attacked by pirates, and sea travel is not viable, so I have to find another way out by helping the locals and going through the Snake Temple. After that, I get to Ravenshore, the Dark Elf Shore city where that huge pink structure was erected. This city is so iconic to me. It's so large and pretty. There are different districts with different kinds of people living in them. There's literally a ghetto there, and it's full of trash that you can dig through for items in exchange of getting aids. There's also the first chapel of Eep in the zone. There's literally a questline where you have to go around the world collecting rare cheese from the dead hands of rat people in their temples. Even better, there's a hornet nest level. This game has some of the best content in the series. And this time it's way easier to consume, as the enemy density is way lower. The game in general is a lot shorter, and I can't really recall any enemies with outrageous abilities anymore, and those used to make Might and Magic games a lot grindier. The first half of the game has the player looking for allies to solve the crisis. This means that in every playthrough you have to side with 3 out of 5 factions aside from the ones that are automatically your friends, making the other 2 your enemies. This also replaces the good and evil alignment system with something morally grey, which I think is pretty neat. No matter what, you have to help out the Minotaurs, because they are really cool and nice, and I don't think I've ever seen a female Minotaur before. They're just cows with 2 legs. But then you have to choose between knights of Grotty Gorge or dragons. The knights would seem like the reasonable option as they're the human faction, but they're hunting the wild dragons pretty much just for sport. And dragons? Well, if you side with them, you get to recruit some. Oh yeah, I didn't mention that with the other races on purpose. Dragons are friggin' amazing. They can't equip anything aside from amulets and rings, but they can fly and they're really strong, especially for early game. They only have 1 weakness. They only attack using fireball projectiles, which in a way are great because they don't have a random chance to miss like arrows, but it makes them unable to hit the weakest enemies in any RPG from up close due to small hitbox. Rats. But yeah, I have no clue why you wouldn't want to have 1 or 2 dragons in your party. Also, fighting them is pretty scary. After that, you also have to pick between necromancers and clerics. This is more obvious as it's straight up a choice between light and dark. But this also depends a lot on what characters you have and what type of magic do you need to master more, light or dark. So this one can really go either way as well. Now that's what I call grave robbery. After all that, you need to deal with the Regnant Pyron Fleet, which is pretty fun, and free 4 mad elementals from their planes, so they could help you enter and destroy the pink crystal in Ravenshore. These quests are pretty nice in my opinion, because they have the player travel through old zones, showing how much improvement he went throughout the game, being able to defeat enemies that were way too strong before and such. Aside from all that, there's still the Archmage tournament, which is still really fun, and there are some extra cards now. To level up skills, you still need to search for the trainers around the world, just barging into every single house. Classes still have promotion quests, but I believe there's only one promotion for each class now. So a whole lot of things are still exactly the same as in two previous games. Some changes might be for the worse, some for the better. Unlike the perception skill is finally useful and allows to see traps, and it's utilized in a more interesting way. For example, in the first dungeon, the Snake Temple, there's a place with false floor, but you can see the safe path pattern if you look at the ceiling and have high enough perception skill. It might also reveal secret doors that lead to treasures and such. It feels like it's worth investing into utility skills even more in this game. The skills that felt useless in previous titles, like pickpocketing for example, have been either changed or removed. Also, with this game being much shorter, I felt like it didn't have me do as many optional tasks just to get strong enough to progress, and was more focused on the main story. And this time, I even managed to keep track of what's even going on. I must say, though, the ending was a bit disappointing. Close your ears now, if you don't want spoilers for a 20-year-old game. Remember how the previous games would end with me getting a bunch of laser blasters and shooting tons of aliens to resolve some issue of galactic importance? Day of the Destroyer is not quite like that. Of course, doing it for the third time would be predictable, but things feel anticlimactic. You end up uniting a bunch of factions and the ancient elementals to get that one bastard that hurt everyone and hid inside the pink crystal. There are no blasters this time. In a way, it's nice because blasters used to be so overpowered they made all the previous skills you had to master nearly useless in comparison, but they're still so much fun. Also, the crystal is probably the hardest part of the game. Not the last zone itself, to which you can get through a portal that's inside the crystal. There are these crystal dragons inside the big crystal. They're real tough. There's not much space to maneuver in, and if I can remember correctly, they're immune to all magic, making it hard to deal much damage to them. After that, you teleport to another dimension or something that's full of just blob creatures that you can very easily just fly over. Then I meet the so-called Destroyer, and he tells that he only started the Cataclysm because the planet was infested with Kreegans, but all of them died out anyway, making the Cataclysm pointless. The dude is only continuing because his masters told him to, but he gave me a chance to stop him by asking some riddles. So I answer the riddles, get the keys for some last chambers that don't hold any dangers I haven't seen before. I stop the Cataclysm and destroy the plane between planes. The Destroyer dies, revealing that he was some cyborg all along, and he sends a drone to his superiors or something like that, leaving the story on an eternal cliffhanger. But everyone lives happily ever after anyway. What a perfect end to a dark fantasy game, am I right? Overall, it's a still very enjoyable game that does a great job at improving at least some aspects and mixing up the old Might and Magic formula. The setting and presentation were just lovely, the soundtrack was beautiful, and so on. I doubt we'll see another proper Might and Magic RPG game, but it would be nice to see the recruitment mechanic come back. In my opinion, gathering new and unique companions with their own stories and personalities in similar games like Lisa the Painful is really neat, and games like Divinity Original Sin 2 proved that such system can also have very well written companions, adding a whole lot of replayability just to be able to experience other character stories. Either way, I see myself returning to Might and Magic 8 rather often. It's a very cozy game for me. For the gimmick part of my reviews, A music album that fits the game? I'd say The Smell of Rain by Mortis fits the Day of the Destroyer rather well. It was released only a year later than the game, but it is also a one-time departure from his earlier works. Mortis' music involves a lot of world-building, that's like a dark version of Lord of the Rings. And also the somewhat flawed but still very charming sound of the album brings up very similar feelings as the game does in me. And with this, I can conclude my review of Might & Magic games, as I've finished my favorite trilogy and get on to something different. God damn it.